Hello there, it's Andy, and I'm out for a very small hike. I've just left my village behind me, and as you can see, I'm possibly 100 yards outside the village, and I'm taking a well-trodden route by myself, and I'm going to take you to something a little bit special. I've got plenty of wild flowers beginning to burst through on the hedge here, and just for example there's a nice very butter coloured yellow pansy here, and it's really starting to throw that look of early summer into the hedgerow. There are plenty of dandelions that are coming through, and they are real vibrant yellow. But I don't suppose those flowers will last long, because rabbits, and there's plenty of rabbit holes in this hedge, they do are very and extremely partial to dandelions. We have some pinks here, some lilac, and some white. And like I said, the hedgerow is just becoming to come alive with actual colours. There's some fresh digging here in the hedge. Now, that is an extensive amount of work gone in there. And with the size of that hole, I'm possibly guessing that's possibly badger, not rabbit, because that is two if not three times the size of what it would be for the humble British rabbit in any case. And even though this lane isn't used a lot, I would suggest it's probably not fox, because they do like to be a little bit more hidden away. And yet again, you can clearly see there's been a lot of excavation here, and it may look like it's a little bit smaller, but it's just loose roots covering that hole. It is still a substantial size, and I'm more convinced that it's badger, and I'll quickly show you as I walk further down this track why I believe so. And a very small distance from that hole, or holes, I come up to a field. Now, this field is usually planted with crops of whatever description's being planted of that particular type and vein for the rotation, I suppose. And more often than not, I will see badgers scurrying around in this entrance. And indeed, on many occasions, I've had the pleasure of walking pretty much up to them, hearing them make a slight grunting noise, stare at me before scuttling off back into the field and the actual crops that are being or are planted in here. So it's not without any grounds that I believe them to be badger holes. I'm walking on a quiet country lane, and I will be doing this most of this particular hike. There is some off-road sections, and they're quite pleasing, and I'll obviously show you those. But where I'm taking you to is a man-made structure, and it's quite a significant one, and it holds a lot of spiritual value to this area. I've just stopped at a gateway, and that's what you do when you walk along the country lanes, because why not? And you get to take in the view, and if you've got no hurry to be anywhere, it is basically almost mandatory to stop and have a look. From here I can see the church spire of St. Mellor. I believe that's the second highest in Cornwall. And indeed, the right hand side there is an Iron Age hill fort, which I've talked about before. But there is a haze in the air, and the weather set to change. We've had wall-to-wall sunshine, but it's due to rain now, and I think it's due to get a lot colder. That little disc there denotes a public footpath, as it states there, and it's pointing in the direction. If you were to look up through this field, up there, you can see another gateway, making its way through the agricultural land to a farm eventually, main road, then down into some more lanes, and you can come back into my village. And indeed, this is the loop I do if I'm looking for a short little walk just to get out and clear my head. But I shan't be going this way. I'm going to be heading off down the valley now instead of staying on the top. This is a nice example of a footpath, clearly marked and with well placed and managed and cut back steps so you can gain access and make your way over to the distance where basically you have to go if you're following that footpath. I am not doing that one either today. That is heading in completely the opposite direction I want to go. But it's just a nice example of access to a public footpath via a step system over a hedge. And it's nice to see things like this being kept, well kept, rather than let just go completely to rack and ruin. I've just walked down this particular bit of lane and the whole hedge is covered in daffodils and it looks really, really beautiful. They're not the most biggest and stunning, but it's just the fact that it is completely covered as far as the eye can see, and it really has an effect. And further down, the whole hedge is covered in those pansies. That is a church spire, but I will not be heading in that direction. I will be heading in this direction here, which you can't see at the moment, but completely the opposite direction. So I'm going to make my way down that piece of lane now. Nothing says spring more than baby lambs, and here we have quite a lot, quite skittish, running off to their mothers as soon as I moved. But yeah, nothing says spring more than baby lambs. I'm now in a field and you can see evident storm damage there, but I should be going completely past that and won't be investigating, as I need to make my way down over this hill and get further down into the valley. This really is what you would call quintessential Cornish countryside here, rolling valleys with a river system at the bottom and indeed just basically woodland and that just general air of tranquility. What have we come to see here that I've been talking about that I was going to show you? Well, as you can see, there's a lot of gorse in the way. And that's a common feature on steep hillsides. We have to actually get through that and down, to the very bottom of this particular hill. So I've made it to the bottom of this hill and there's a thick wall of gorse. But if you go to the very corner, there's enough of an area or room for you to come around it. And indeed, it looks like it has been cleared to give some sort of access to where we're going. There has been some management here just recently. A lot of the trees obviously suffered damage during the storms and they've been taken back a bit to, well, really to prolong their life and give them a little bit more, shall we say, of like a clean up, so they're healthier, because storm damage obviously weakens the tree and leaves it open to disease. And obviously, you know, as with everything living, if there's like open wounds and everything like that, you can get fungal infections and everything like that. So trees are no different than us. They do need regular checkups, if we want to use that terminology. So you can see the hill that we've just come down, and I'm going to spin the camera around and we'll walk to our destination. And there is a little bit of an air about it, so I hope you can pick up on the camera the actual spiritual nature of where we're actually particularly at. And I'm just making my way down through the track, avoiding the rabbit holes and cattle tracks. And as we come round, in view, there is a structure. Now that might not be grabbing you first off, but we'll walk around and have a look. And as you get closer, you can definitely feel that this is something just a little bit different. And you can tell this has been here a long time. It has that air of history, and indeed, you know, you can feel it. But this is a holy well. This is the holy well of St. Mellor. So we are basically at the bottom of a hillside rolling away from the slightly higher ground. And what that means is we've got a natural spring. And just taking you inside, if you can see, there's a little hole or cubby hole. Looks like there's a little bit of remnants of a candle there, but I believe there would have possibly been a statue to possibly the saint himself, St. Mellor, or a statue honouring his existence. But yeah, this water here is considered holy and is used by the actual church to this day for its services that require holy water. And it looks like somebody's placed some gorse up there. It is quite boggy underfoot, and you'd expect that because we are in the ground is lying very low, and indeed you can see that it is extremely boggy. The water is running out of the actual well and it's making its way down to the stream and river. But it really does have a nice spiritual feel about it here. And it looks like there was probably a gate or a doorway there. You can see hinges. They're no longer there. And I'm trying to walk around this without actually getting myself absolutely bogged in, I'll use that word. A lot of the mortar has disappeared between the joints, but that's to be expected for how long this has more than likely been here. I'm not going to attempt going in there because it's really, really boggy. So the water to this holy well was obviously used by the church on top of the hill, which it shares its same name, the holy well of St. Mellor and the church of St. Mellor on top of the hill. But the water was said to cure ailments surrounding horses and things like that. Now that might sound trivial, but back in the day when this was made, put on top of the spring, horses were the draft animals. They did all the heavy burden, they did all the work, and they retained a lot of personal value. So an injured horse or a horse that had an issue was not to be taken lightly back in those days. So hence, you know, the importance placed on the water here to cure the horse's ailments. So yeah, I'm going to move on now, make my way back the way I come, back out into the lane and hit the footpaths again. And I'll be trying to get a little bit of an off-road section in. This well, it is a special place. It is tucked away. You know, it's not somewhere you just casually stroll up to and you would have seen that. But it is not unique in Cornwall. There are a lot of holy wells in Cornwall, and indeed Cornwall carries a lot of saint names for place names within the county and the local parishes. And in some respects people have quoted Cornwall as the land of saints. But I'm going to make my way out of here now. I hope you enjoyed that and you could feel something of that specialness to this holy well and the area it actually is sitting. I'm now swiftly going to pass through the village itself and make my way down to a public footpath. Yeah, crows are pretty active and noisy. Now, as I climb back out of this valley to make my headway to a footpath I'm going to use to actually get home, you can actually see down through the particular valley we've just been. Now, somewhere down there is that well hidden, and for all intents and purposes, if you didn't know it was there, lost in time. But we've just been there, we've seen it, and I'm sure you can agree that was quite a special little building there on that holy well. And like I said, I'm going to make my way home. Just a quick note, and it's worthy of a note. If you look along that telegraph wire along there, you'll see the ramparts of the actual Iron Age hill fort. Between there's two bits of hedge on top of it, but that is the actual ramparts looking down into this valley from that Iron Age hill fort. And it's just worth a note. And on the telegraph pole, you can quite clearly see the arrow states the public footpath is up here, and I can see the sty. But I know I have to gain access to it up a ramp, walk along to the sty, and then over. So here it is, you scrabble up the bank, along the hedge, and you make your way to that sty there, and you make your way up through the hedgerow to the next field system. But I'm now going to climb up here and do my level best without sliding backwards. The ground is quite dry and loose soil, and I'm pushing hard there, get my balance. And you can clearly see it's marked there, and we'll be going up through there using that gate over there. But I've got to use this to get over this fence system now. Always secure the gate after yourself, then it just makes it less unpleasant if you have to deal with the landowner themselves. Do everything according to what you should do, and it'll smooth your way. As a walker, that's all you can do. Just make it, make yourself as less visible and cause as little interruption as you can to the landowner. And it's all in the vein to make the use of the public footpath, should we say, more enjoyable for yourself and without any of the associated aggro by basically upsetting the landowner. So here's my target, and that's easily doable by myself, and I can get over that. There's a bit of cordage there, obviously. The landowner has done that just to make it a little bit more secure for their horses, I'm guessing. But for myself, I can quite easily, when I say easy, I just well went back down, get over this actual sty and get my foot over there. And now I'm on top of the hedge, and I now have a stepped system down into this field here. Now I've just come down over that one, and as you can see, it's new fencing. And I can remember when this fencing was first put in, there was no actual sty, so it was pretty difficult to negotiate this barbed wire. But as you can see, it's now in situ, and things are, shall we say, as they should be, and they're extremely easy and usable to negotiate for this footpath. The footpath obviously runs down this hedge system here. I do know the actual exit is in the hedge down there somewhere. I can't see an exit point there now, so I'm guessing it's going to be the gate down there we will be using. But on the OS map system, it is in the hedge, roughly about halfway down that hedge system. Just a quick one though, if a field is tilled with crops or anything like that, And, you know, there is no visible footpath across, and your map says it is dead across, unless there is clear evidence that the farmer has made that pathway for you to go across. I would always advise to skirt around the outside of the field, and don't just break or bushwhack your own trail through virgin crops. Obviously, if there is a footpath and it's been broken already for you to go through, I don't see that being a problem. But never just bushwhack your own path through if there isn't one. Stick to the outside of the actual hedge or field system and make your way out then. Just come down that hedgerow there, hit the corner and come to here. And in there, you might just be able to make out a granite stone. I'm hitting it there, and you can probably see the remnants out onto the road of where that footpath came out onto the road. But as you can see, it's been allowed to get overgrown, and I dare say at some point it will be reinstated, but at the moment the walkers are just making their way down through along this hedge line and out through the gate. But that being said, this is the official OS map and historical exit and entrance to this footpath. So I've made it to the gateway, as we've just described, and I'm here now on a road, or a lane, shall I say. And from here, I can look up to where I've come from and back up the lane I'm going to take now to make my way home. This is the backside of what we've just been looking at, the true original historic, shall we say, entrance. And you can see up through there that you've got sky and there's a historical path. You can see the granite stone and you can see where the hedge has just been allowed to grow over for many years. But it's just a case walkers have just walked down to the gate just out of ease. But it will be nice if this actually gets put back into use. Its original use, as in its original historic context. Well, I've done a full circle and I'm back into my village. And my houses are not too far up the road. So I'm going to call this, an end to this video. I hope you enjoyed seeing that well. It's a pretty special place. And indeed, not many people these days get to see it, and very few people even know about its existence. So there is a little bit of a specialness to that holy well. So I'm going to call it a day, and I hope you enjoyed seeing that, and I hope you enjoyed a little bimble around the lanes with me for a very small hike. This is Andy from Folklore Hiking Sticks signing out. Cheers.